Check it out now, y'all.
nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hello, and welcome back to nanoHUB-U's Introduction to Bioelectricity. Now we are in week three, and we're talking about models of biological conductors. In this lecture, we're going to describe the very first of the models and the foundation for all subsequent models that we will discuss in this course. And this model describes the relationship between voltages and currents inside and outside of a cell. It is called the core conductor model, and it was not, in fact, initially developed to describe neurons at all. So an axon, if you look at it, looks like a long cylindrical object, and it resembles any long cylindrical object. So in fact, the core conductor model was initially developed to discuss transatlantic phone cables and long cables that had to carry electrical signals over a long period of time physical dimension. So in a long cable, in an ideal cable, you're always going to have a situation in which there's no current leakage and the voltage present at one end ends up being the voltage present at the other. But in a real cable, you always have some leakage, and that leakage is modeled with resistance between the inner and outer conductors. It's modeled with a series of capacitances which leak high frequency signals and so on. And that resembles in many respects what you have in a neuron. You have the capacitance given to you by the membrane with the charged ions on both sides, potassium on the outside, the anions on the inside. You have a resistance that's given to you by the leakage of the membrane, but also by the ion channels as they open and close. And because of the similarities between that and transatlantic phone wires or telegraph cables, you have the ability to take the core conductor equation developed for that application and apply it to our own, which is what we'll do here in this lecture. So you have an axon. Let's say that you zoom in and you take a segment out of the membrane of that axon, and you break that segment up into three separate zones: the intracellular environment on the inside of the axon, the membrane itself, and the extracellular environment on the outside of the axon. You can talk about currents inside, outside, and in the membrane, and voltages in those same locations. So we'll define a series of variables. I, which we've talked about before, is the current. So I sub I is the current inside the cell, and it is a function of Z, the position along the length of the axon, and T, time. V, which we've defined before as voltage, V sub I is the voltage inside the cell. It is also a function of Z and T. I, which is current, sub O, current outside of the cell, is a function of Z and T, and V sub O, the voltage outside the cell, is also a function of Z and T. These currents, I sub in and I sub out, are flowing along the axis of the cell, inside and outside. The voltage exists at a point with reference to a different point. So these are local potentials. K sub M, K, if you recall, we defined as the current per unit length. Here, K sub M is the current per unit length flowing through the membrane. So the K sub M for the membrane, flowing through the membrane, so it flows perpendicularly to the current inside and the current outside of the cell. And these values are all taken at a point Z. If you move an infinitesimal segment delta Z down along the axis of the neuron, you're going to have the current inside the cell as a function of Z plus delta Z and T, still flowing axially along the neuron on the inside. You have the current I sub O, the current outside the cell, as a function of Z plus delta Z and T, flowing outside the neuron, but still axially. The current, the transmembrane current per unit length, K sub M, as a function of Z plus delta Z and T, flowing perpendicularly to the membrane from the inside to the outside. And you'll have the inside voltage, the outside voltage, and the membrane voltage, all as a function of Z plus delta Z and T, where the inside voltage is inside, the outside voltage is outside, but now at a different point, and the membrane voltage remains the difference between the inside voltage and the outside voltage. So it exists between the two, one with respect to the other. So we're going to make some assumptions. Those assumptions are that the membrane separates two homogeneous conductors, so that the material inside the neuron, whatever it is homogeneous. And we know that's not true, but we can approximate it as a homogeneous conductor, and electrically, that approximation, that assumption, holds up pretty well. We do the same thing from the outside, that the extracellular fluid in which that neuron sits is homogeneous. All electrical variables are going to be independent of phi. So recall, in our cylindrical coordinate system, we have three axes. One is the z-hat direction, which flows along the axis of the axon. The other is the r-hat direction, which is radially out from the axon in any direction. And the final one is phi, which is the rotating, the angular direction, which flows around the axon. What we're saying when we say that the electrical variables are independent of phi is that as you move around a constant radius, moving around the cell, you're not going to see a variation in current and voltage. So not only is the current, the medium homogeneous, but the current is homogeneous in the phi hat direction. Inner and outer conductors are going to be equipotential, which means that all of the voltages inside the conductor and outside the conductor are going to be equipotential with the inner and outer respectively, not with one another, and that the variation in potential is going to occur radially. So changes in voltage are going to be occurring radially as we move through the membrane. They're not going to be occurring, again, as a function of V as we move around. They will also occur as a function of R, but the voltage will always be taken radially. We have a number of variables. I sub I is the current inside the conductor or cell. I sub O is the current outside the conductor or cell. K sub M is the membrane current. K sub E is a new term. It's an external current applied per unit length. Well, that's why we're using the variable K instead of I. It's an external current applied, for example, by an electrode. So this allows us, if we take this into account from the beginning, to simulate the effects of approaching an electrode to the neuron and electrically stimulating that cell. R sub O and R sub I will describe the resistance per unit length. So like K, they are per unit length of the outer conductor for R sub O and the inner conductor for R sub I. And then finally, A will describe the radius. And we use A rather than R to describe radius so we don't confuse ourselves between radius and resistance. So if we look again at that membrane, we can draw an equivalent circuit for the membrane itself, where we say that if we break the element, the membrane down into infinitesimal segments, each of length delta z, we can say that a single segment has an internal impedance, ri, which is the impedance per unit length inside the cell, multiplied times delta z. So the resistance per unit length times the length of the unit gives you the resistance of that unit. So ri delta z. Similarly, for the outside, you have a resistance of RO delta Z, and then you have a internal current I sub I, an external current I sub O, and a transmembrane current K sub M is the current per unit length, multiplied by the length delta Z gives you the total current flowing through the membrane at that infinitesimal segment delta Z. And if you move delta Z down, you move from Z to Z plus delta Z, you're going to have the same resistances, RI delta Z, RI delta Z, RO delta Z, RO delta Z, and repeating as long as you have an axon. But now your membrane voltage will be evaluated at Z plus delta Z, and so will your membrane current inside, your membrane current and your inside current and your outside current. And doing this allows us to then label the nodes. So we've broken the membrane down into these infinitesimal blocks. We can label each of these nodes A, B, C, and D, and we can apply Kirchhoff's current law. Applying Kirchhoff's current law, and if you recall from refreshment physics, Kirchhoff's current law says that the current into a node equals the current out of the node. So however many currents you have flowing into a node being a junction between separate wires, as they're drawn here, however many currents you have flowing into the node, you sum them. And however many currents you have flowing out of a node, you sum them. And the sum of the currents into the node and the sum of the currents out of the node have to be equal. For them not to be equal would imply that if you had a positive value, you were somehow creating current at that node, which is impossible. unless you have a current source, which will add a current to the node and still make Kirchhoff's current law hold true, or that current was somehow disappearing. And current describes the flow of charge. So those charged particles cannot disappear. It's like water flowing through pipes. Whatever amount of water flows into a juncture between two pipes has to equal the sum of the waters flowing out of those pipes. Otherwise, you'd be creating water. So Kirchhoff's current law summarizes that, and so applying Kirchhoff's current law at node A, we can say that the current flowing into the node, which is I sub I evaluated as Z and T, is equal to the current flowing into the next node, which is I sub I, the current inside the cell evaluated as Z plus delta Z and T, plus however much current flows out of the membrane, which is Km evaluated as Z and T, multiplied times delta Z, that infinitesimal current length, because Km is current per unit length. So this is an equation describing the currents at node A. We can do Kirchhoff's current law at node D. And so calculating Kirchhoff's current law at node D, we find that the current flowing out of the cell, the current flowing out of the cell at Z and T, plus the membrane current being added to it at this point, Z, which is a function of Z and T, multiplied times the infinitesimal segment delta Z, is equal to the current flowing out of that node C, IO, multiplied times, or evaluated at Z plus delta Z and T, plus, recall that electrode current, which can be zero, but it doesn't have to be zero, and this way we can explore stimulation of the neuron, KE, and because it's a current per unit length, it's multiplied times delta Z. So we've evaluated with Kirchhoff's current law the sum of the currents at nodes A and C. From Ohm's law inside the cell, recall Ohm's law tells us that the voltage is equal to the current times the resistance, while the voltage inside the cell is equal to VI at Z at T minus VI evaluated at the next point. So this is the voltage drop inside the cell. And that voltage drop has to equal to the current through that node or through that segment multiplied times the resistance of that segment. The resistance is RI delta Z, and the current is RI sub I evaluated at Z plus delta Z and T. That's Ohm's law for this segment. We can do it outside the cell and come up with Ohm's law for this segment, where it's VO evaluated at this point minus VO evaluated at this point, and that's equal to RO times delta Z times IO evaluated as Z plus delta Z and T. So those are just Ohm's law evaluated inside and outside of the cell. So we have four equations now. Let's write them all together. We can rearrange and divide these equations. And the four equations, again, are the sum of the currents at the node inside the cell evaluated at the distance Z, the sum of the equations at outside the cell at that same point along the axon, the Ohm's law telling us what the voltage drop, how that relates to the current flowing through the inside of the cell, Ohm's law telling us how the voltage drop outside the cell relates to the current flowing outside the cell through the exterior resistance. We've rearranged them. We can divide them by delta Z to put them in this form. So now we have the difference in the currents at the next node and this node inside the cell divided by the length of the segment is equal to minus Km. IO evaluated at the next point minus this point divided by the distance is equal to Km minus Ke. The voltage inside at the next node minus the voltage at this node divided by delta Z is equal to negative Ri II. And similarly, the voltage outside at the next node minus the voltage outside at this node divided by the distance is equal to negative RO times IO. If we take the limit of these equations as delta Z goes to zero, we arrive at this differential form of these four equations. The derivative with respect to Z of the current inside the cell is equal to negative Km. The derivative with respect to Z of the current outside the cell is equal to Km minus Ke. The derivative of the voltage inside the cell with respect to Z is equal to minus Ri II, and the derivative with respect to Z of the voltage outside the cell is equal to minus Ro IO. These four equations are the core conductor equations, plural. But we'll simplify them further by noting that the membrane voltage is equal to the voltage inside the cell minus the voltage outside the cell. And therefore, the derivative of the membrane voltage is equal to the derivative of the voltage inside the cell minus the derivative of the voltage outside the cell, because we're differentiating across the equation, both sides. That allows us to substitute equations 3 and 4 from the last slide and express the membrane voltage as with respect to Z as being equal to minus RIII plus RO. But from differentiating again with respect to Z tells us that the second derivative of the membrane voltage with respect to Z squared is equal to RO times the first derivative of the outside current with respect to Z minus RN times the first derivative of the inside current with respect to Z. When we can substitute equations 1 and 2 from two slides back to yield the second derivative of the membrane voltage, which is a function of both space and time, with respect to the second derivative of space, is equal to the sum of the outside resistance of the cytoplasm and the internal resistance of the intracellular cytoplasm multiplied times the membrane current per unit length, which is also a function of Z and T, minus the external impedance RO multiplied times the applied electrode current per unit length, which is a function of Z and T. And this is the core conductor equation. That's what we've been looking at to derive today, and that's the model that we are focusing on first. So let us recap. The core conductor model describes the relationship between currents inside the cell and currents outside the cell, between voltages inside the cell and voltages outside the cell, and between the transmembrane current given specific impedances inside the cell and impedances outside the cell. And it puts all of that in terms of the second derivative of the membrane voltage. So if we know what these impedances are and what this membrane current is, we can calculate the membrane voltage as a function of space and time. And that's a very important result, but it's not everything. In fact, there's something clearly that we don't know. So all along, we've been looking at this model and I've been drawing these boxes, these blank boxes. These boxes define the membrane and the electrical equivalent circuit of the membrane through which the membrane current per unit length, Km, flows. But we haven't said anything about what's in those boxes. So what we have here is an equation, essentially, with two unknowns. We don't know what the membrane voltage is, and we don't know what the membrane current is. If we want to solve an equation with two unknowns, we need a second equation with those same two unknowns. And so what we're going to need is another equation that relates the membrane voltage to the membrane current per unit length. And the way we arrive at that is by exploring what is inside this blank box. What is the equivalent circuit of this blank box? And how does that equivalent circuit relate membrane voltage and membrane current? And then how do we couple that equation with this equation to come up with a solution for the membrane voltage for all possible combinations of input stimuli? And that's where we'll go with the next two models. So the core conductor forms the base, but it does not by itself allow us to make predictions about action potential flow or passive conduction in a neuron. We'll begin to explore what's inside these blank boxes. Initially, we'll look at it for passive neurons, and that will give us, for passive action or electrical flow in a neuron, and that will give us the cable model. And then we'll move on beyond that, and we'll begin to look at active processes with variable impedances as ion channels open and close, and that will give us the Hodgkin-Huxley model, which we'll discover next week in the fourth week of this course. But for this week, we still have the core conductor or the cable equation and the cable model, and before that, some conclusions and observations that we'll draw in the next lecture about the core conductor model. I will see you then.